Yeah? Shall we begin? First of all, I want to thank Mr. Eugene Kaspersky, CEO of Kaspersky Labs, and all, of course, all the honorable participants here. Some of us know Mr. Kaspersky and what he's doing. And
I think so. Some people there are my customers.
Yeah.
Yes. How many people? How many people here in the room are my customers? Okay. Thank you so much.
But I want Mr. Batal, Director Manager, Minister of Communication, to say some words on behalf of us. Thank you.
Eugene, first of all, welcome. I want to thank the association, the Eyes of Israel, for another very important activity. Clearly, this activity, your presence here, cannot be exaggerated by its importance. You are one of the people in the world that know best the Israelis' attention to this, I would say, phenomena that's getting greater day by day. On the other hand, the Israelis as a government and as private organizations pay greater attention to the cyber issues, and we believe that in order to have a flourishing technology environment and to use all the benefits of that for all, some major issues should be, I don't want to use the word resolved because I don't believe in resolved. First of all, it will destroy your business to resolve it, but clearly the imagination of many people coming together to create issues and problems can be met only by other great people that try to ease the situation a bit and allow the environment of the internet and the users, meaning the population of the world, being able to use and protect themselves and starting to really to use technology, especially the ones that are less privileged in the world. They need technology even more than us. And we can only thank you for your contribution in this field. I'm sure every Israeli know you very well. And if somebody didn't know you a few years ago, certainly in the last year, you become
yes.
more famous.
I know.
Even in the not professional,
For the flame.
I have the story. Yes, about this.
Stories, you mean? A lot
the stories.
Of stories. So I hope you'll enjoy your time in Israel, and I don't want to spend more time of the people over here that would like probably to share with you their insights and also to hear you, which is the main reason to come here. I want to apologize that I have to attend another event shortly, but I will.
I'll be short. Well, first of all, it's true that the level of the cybersecurity issues awareness is growing very quick, and I recognize it personally. Well, last time I was in Israel was last year, in June last year. I came here, and well, this time I came to Israel. It was very easy to go, so it was very smooth. Last time I was interviewed, that's like a what are you doing? Cybersecurity. Which kind of cybersecurity? What are you doing? Cybersecurity, the endpoint protection against this, cyber threats, malicious code. What do you know about Flame? That was the second question from the officer. This time I came to Washington, there was two weeks ago, I came to Washington, D.C., and there was passport control, and the officer asked me, what's the reason to come to the United States? I said, cybersecurity. Welcome to the United States.
So it's
a unfortunately, cybersecurity issues are getting more and more important. But I don't want. This is a usual mistake when people they mix all the cybersecurity issues in just one place. They're different. If you're talking about the I have this explanation. If you're talking about your state security, national security, it's about border control, it's about healthcare, it's about the fire stations. In Japan, also earthquakes. But you don't mix it all together. There are different issues. So in cyberspace, unfortunately, many people are still, they mix it all together. The cyber criminals, hacktivists, terrorists, it's like, okay, that's computer virus. But that's a different things. And I will split these issues in three different categories. So cybercrime, espionage, and cyber sabotage. Cyber sabotage, it's Stuxnet attack, it's attack on Estonia, it's attack on the...
Georgia.
It's attack on Saudi Aramco, your best friend. It's attack on South Korea this year. So this kind of attacks, I call it cyber sabotage. Attack on Tel Aviv Stock Exchange, somewhere in between. So it's bad, but it's not as bad as other attacks. It's damaging, but not too much. If the bad guys are able to stop stock exchange for a couple of days, I will call it cyber terrorism. It was just a little. Not yet. It's very difficult to draw the border. So, cyber criminals. Cyber criminals. We have technologies. We understand. We have technologies to protect. We understand the nature of cybercrime. We know who these people are. Interpol finally opening the office in Singapore, addressing the cybercrime issues. So I'm pretty sure that cybercrime will have not so easy time very, very soon. And Internet Interpol, or Cyberpol, they call it. This is a complex of innovations in Singapore. It's a very promising project, and so there are organizations around that, sponsoring that. There's an Interpol kind that is a Singapore government, which just made their office for free. And it's a NEC, NEC, Japanese company, which is providing the hardware for free for this complex. We will provide our technologies, knowledge, software, our software, and our experts to assist Interpol. So I'm pretty sure that cybercrime will have a bad times very soon. So it will be more or less under the control. It will not kill my business. Anyway, there will be criminals. So it's like, doesn't matter how many policemen you have in the streets, how many cameras you have in the streets, the crime, the traditional crime will still exist. So don't worry about my business.
But it will be more sophisticated, I see.
It will be more sophisticated, only very professional. So it will be not so many criminals in the business. It will be more easy to have a cash in the Tel Aviv streets because, well, yesterday I tried 5 or 4 ATMs. They don't accept Russian credit cards. Maybe because of the crime.
Exactly.
Yes, yeah. So I understand that, I respect that, but in 10 years from now, I want to have a cash machine, ATM, working with any card. So I have less crime in this space. Yeah, so that affects everyone, including me.
Yes.
So.
You need the loan now?
No. I have playing cards. So it's easy to fix the problem. If I don't have cash, I can play. I'm kidding. I have cards with me, I'm not kidding. Okay, so that's about cybercrime. Espionage. Extremely, extremely bad situation because the espionage attacks, they're under the control. They're not under the control. Too many, and it's very easy to spy in the cyberspace. Well, I think I don't need to explain that. How many companies were victims of successful espionage attacks? We don't know. Some people say that there are companies that are split in two categories. Companies which were victims of the espionage attacks and they know that. And the companies which were victims of these attacks and they don't know that. I will say there are three types of companies. They were attacked and they know that. They were attacked, they don't know that. And security company. We will not tell you. Unfortunately, there are many. We have NDAs with many organizations, and we can report to you their numbers. Unfortunately, many, very many. So there's no more secrets in the cyberspace. It's very easy. All the data is stored somewhere in the digital form. And the worst is that in a traditional espionage attacks, they just copy, make pictures, they're stealing, they can't modify. In some cases, they can modify, but in most of cases, it's just a copying. In cyberspace, it's easy to modify. If you're a victim of the espionage attack, it means you can't trust your data anymore.
So yes.
Even worse. Real story. We're assisting hydropower plants with security software, with special adapted security software. And we had access to the computers, which were used to develop software for SCADA for power plants. And these computers, they were infected by Chinese backdoors. It doesn't only mean that it was all the data was stolen, there was some watching. It means that maybe they could modify the source code. That reminds me of the story in 2005 or 2004. I don't remember the name of the project in Israel. There was a military project, the missile. And the software, I don't have any idea. You may better ask Gadi Evron. Do you know Gadi Evron? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So he was digging this issue. So software was made by a non-Israeli company. It's a global company. They have offices in many countries around the world. By mistake, they sent a request to develop this software to your another best friend, your neighbor, behind the Suez Channel. Well, actually the country which owns the Suez Channel, Egypt, and well, Israeli military software made by Egypt. So, well, actually, in the cyberspace, we're talking about espionage, that's reality. Unfortunately, they can steal everyone. And I don't want to say they. I will be very surprised if Israel is innocent and is not watching some other nations what they're doing. I will be very surprised. So unfortunately, many nations, they are watching each other. Most of the attacks, they speak Chinese, but there are many other languages as well. So it's behind Atlantic, it's before Atlantic, it's in the West, in the East, Russia, and every nation which has abilities to do that, I will be very surprised if they don't do that. And the worst thing is, it's not just about the espionage. It's very easy to upgrade with a warhead. It's very easy to compromise the data, to change the data in a cyberspace. Well, and actually, I don't really know what to do with that, because espionage is taken as it's reality. Espionage did exist, does exist, and will exist in the future. Nations, states will spy on each other. It's not possible to stop. But in cyberspace, it's so bad that, well, 2 days ago, the presidents of United States and China had a meeting, and they were talking about these issues as well. It's just a message how important these issues are. So it's on the same level like a nuclear. Biological is forbidden, so it's no, we forgot what it is. A nuclear is still in place, but not so much. Now it's about cyber. And I came to the cyber sabotage. Still, there are no definitions. What's a cyber war? What's a cyber weapon? What's cyber terrorism? But I explain it in such a way, if the attack is very bad, that's cyber sabotage. So attacks on Estonia, Georgia, Stuxnet, Stuxnet, then there was Viper on Iran. We still don't have any data. Don't have samples. We have only reports from Iran that oil companies were attacked by some malware and data was wiped. Then Saudi Arabia, very same story. And this year, South Korea. So these incidents, I call them cyber sabotage. If there are states behind these attacks, that's cyber war. If there are non-states, hacktivists, it's cyber terrorism. I call it in this way. Not many attacks, but unfortunately, it's just a proof that it's possible to do. And I'm afraid it's the worst of the worst. It's attacks on critical infrastructure in cyberspace. Because we depend on IT systems, they're everywhere. This camera is computer as well, basically, yeah? So they are, I call it from submarines to the space station. These systems, they're managed by computers. A friend of mine who is a pilot, professional pilot of commercial airlines, he told me that the main difference, you know, between Boeing and Airbus is that in Boeing, pilot is more important than computer. So it's everywhere. The power plants, they're extremely complicated systems. And to manage all these physical processes there are no more people, because people are not good for that. If a person is managing these systems, it's more risk that a person will make a mistake. So the computer systems, they're watching all these technological processes. And there are computers, there are touch screens, behind the bars. So you have to unlock it to manage that. I saw it in some organizations. But in some of them, there's still MS-DOS running the physical environment. And unfortunately, we really depend on IT, and I think that some of you, they really have access to this environment, and you know. And I don't want to say it's bad, I don't want to say it's good, it's reality, and actually it's not possible to turn this world back. We can't make step back. It's like we use cars, and cars are the most dangerous innovations of the human history, because cars, they kill more people than anything else. Okay?
But
we can't stop using it. Same with IT technologies. It's dangerous, but we can't stop using them. But it means simply that we need to make it more secure. So that was the first half of my story. I was talking about the threats, and I was scaring you. The second part of my story is about cybercrime. I told you that there is a cue for that. And the second half will be shorter. Actually, I think that there are ways how to make the cyberspace more safe and more secure. And this is a combination of technologies, administration in-house for enterprises and governments, for the organizations which have their confidential, the classified data in the hands, organizations which manage critical infrastructure, military, so there are ways how to make it more safe, more secure in-house, and governments on the government level to introduce regulation for the critical infrastructure and to be more open, more friendly for international cooperation to investigate incidents and to cooperate with other intelligence services to find cyber terrorists in the cyberspace before they press the button. Well, that's it. I can share details about all these issues, about the attacks, about the protection, about the cooperation. So if you want me to dig more, so yeah. I can.
At this moment, I would say thing, and I'm going, but I was very happy to hear it all. And the rest will probably read on the international media about your activities. And I will convey also some of the messages to my organizations. But I live here also, one of my colleagues and from the Ministry of Communication. So we'll also update our team in-house. And I'm sure you're meeting other Israeli governmental entities to share your views. And they are the right addresses probably for that. We are highly bothered by that. And we are sure that our ministry also will have to address this issue more and more in the near future. I'm very happy that it will be another director general and not myself, because I think the situation is not going to be much better in the near future.
In near future, of course, no, but I think that in some
point.
In 10, 20, or 50 years from now, it will be much more safe. Okay. And I do my best, so don't afraid about my business.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Everybody want to ask a question or say something, please just say your name and title, that's all. It's your stage now.
Question about HP and ICKL. And I'm wondering, because some of the points you are raising as a group of governments, and well, let's hope there is a central government that knows how to deal with it. Some of it has to do with enterprises and companies, and I don't see any kind of central facility that takes care of enterprises. And I wonder if an entity such as ISO or other entities worldwide, you see taking part in kind of doing self-regulation or self-knowledge or anything that we can contribute to the industry in Israel to be more aware, more into it, use the right tools, if you see practices worldwide that we can use.
I call it cyber resilience,
yeah.
To be more cyber resilient,
yeah.
To the
it's
cyber
the
attacks.
They are,
yeah. Unfortunately, you are right, and this is one of the major issues that the reality is that the cyber technologies, all this cyber stuff, is so new that governments, they didn't have enough of time to introduce any kind of regulation. If we're talking about them, well, my favorite is a power grid. We have standards, we have engineers, we have education, we have government regulation and penalties. Agree? When you build a building, same. When you build a road, there are standards. If you put not enough of sand under the road, it's corruption. Or it's crime, because there are standards. If you come to IT, do it as you want. Unfortunately, it's some people call it freedom. Well, that's in some cases, there is a very thin border between freedom and anarchy. So I will call it anarchy, because everyone does it in the way they want. So I think that's a government role. When I was talking about technologies, administration, and government control, I think that government must introduce regulation to the critical infrastructure. And I think that governments, they have to split different areas in the different zones. I don't know how many zones. 3, 4, 5, I don't know. But some non-critical systems, I don't know, like public libraries, it's good, but it's not critical. They are in a green zone, so they don't really need to have some extra regulation. Power plant, it's a red zone. They must be regulated, even IT systems. So governments, they need to introduce regulation for the critical infrastructure and other systems somewhere in between. I'm not expert in that. I'm expert in IT security, so I can provide the technologies how to make the systems more secure, but I think it's a government must introduce this regulation. I think that it's very same in different countries, so maybe that could be the international regulation. When? Don't ask me. Ask Knesset. I don't know. But it's a very good idea if we have a good enough government regulation will make the life of enterprises and IT engineers more easy, because well, they do as they want and they're not responsible. If it happens.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to ask a question. My name is Yair Barto and I'm a consultant in the cybersecurity space. I'm a board of security mm-hmm. companies and background in intelligence information mm-hmm. systems. I'm asking you as a specialist, if you were trying to build a protection solution, national level SOC or SOC for critical infrastructure, where would you put more energy to, with all this type of big data analytics, to collect all the logs, things from inside the network or from the intelligence,
no.
open space
no.
intelligence, activist organization, social sentiment, outside from the internet, where would you put more energy in a solution?
I will split the energy into three pieces. First of all, to protect endpoints, to protect critical computer systems. Next year, well, I wasn't going to have any marketing stuff, but next year we're going to introduce so-called default deny systems to protect protect endpoints which are processing or storage for the classified data.
Okay.
to protect it from the espionage attacks.
Okay.
To protect SCADA systems, the critical infrastructure, I will think that the best way is a secure operating system and to redesign SCADA software based on a secure operating system. That's technologies. Then, administrative things which is possible to do in-house. Critical infrastructure. Well, most of critical infrastructure runs Windows. Siemens PLCs, SCADA systems on Windows machines. Some Linux, but most Windows. That's reality. And in, well, the problem is that engineers, they must upgrade the systems because it's a factories, power plants, transportation systems, they're not exactly the same as they were last year, 5 years ago. They're all the time they upgraded because there are new technologies, new roads, new aircrafts, what else? So engineers must upgrade software. So they travel with notebooks, with USBs, with Stuxnet. So it's very easy to stop this. Well, actually, if it's designed against your organization, it will not help you, but it will help you to be protected from the random attacks for collateral damage. Put Linux in between and don't let computers and USBs to travel, to cross the border. Windows computer, okay, copy your data to Linux machine. And then copy this data to another Windows machine, which is from inside of the perimeter. Easy. It will stop from 99% of the attacks. It will save you, but it will not save you from the targeted attack because they will develop Windows, Linux. So this is a very easy, but it's not guaranteed. So the default deny is a better solution, but combination, maybe it will be much better. Then, user's education. The social engineering tricks. We have it for our customers, we have it for our employees in the company. It's a very short presentation, about 45 minutes presentation, with the slides, screenshots of the real attacks, stories. It's just stories, which already happened. It helps a lot. So after this presentation, employees, they become paranoid. After this presentation, if they find the USB somewhere in a parking slot, they will report it to security, not on their own computer. So it's easy. And there are many things which is possible to do inside of organizations. We need just to provide
the intelligence component. You don't believe in that, having open source intelligence, look for the activists, follow the countries, follow social sentiment against your country, organization.
It's a third one. Okay. It's a third one. So. Okay. That was technologies, administrative, and government level. So government level, last year I had a speech on the International Intelligence Forum, NATO forum in Brussels. And my message was that intelligence services must cooperate to find the bad guys, very bad guys, before they press the button. Mm-hmm. Good idea?
You have something to say about
it. Exactly,
it's terrible.
Yeah, same. Exactly. Listen, don't reinvent the bicycle.
Yes, exactly.
Cyberspace is not like a very new. It's just a projection of the real world, but in a different domain. That's it. Some people blame me that I'm against freedom in the internet. So I'm promoting this internet passports, internet IDs. I don't want all internet users to have all the time internet IDs. If you visit just a public service as news, or you chat with your friends, or email your friends, you don't need ID. But if you go to bank, then you go to bank, physical bank. Do you need to present your
ID? Mm-hmm.
Yes. And this is a biometric checking, yes? The person watching, is it you or not? Okay, bottom up. So it's biometric checking, yes? Picture, it's a biometric identification. So the same must be done in a cyberspace. If you want to have your financial, if you have access to financial services, please, your biometrical ID. Well, when the 3D printers are done and the 3D printers they are able to make the fake fingerprints. Oh God, that's bad news. Until we don't have 3D printers for fingerprints, we can use it.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. Later, I don't know. maybe DNA. I don't know. But it's don't reinvent bicycle. It's exactly the same, but in a different domain.
Sorry, my name is Mia, and I am the Isokael CEO. The difference between the physical and the cyber, it's the time. Because when someone broke my house, so I get a beeper, I get an SMS, and I can run to my house or drive there and still catch it, maybe. But in the cyberspace, when someone broke my firewall or my air gap or my Windows, Linux Windows, I don't have the time to react.
If I said it's the same, I was wrong. It's similar, but there are differences. Yeah. In a cyberspace, there are no borders, no time, no distance. Mm-hmm. That's correct.
Espionage
attacks in a reality and in a cyberspace, they're different. Because it's possible to upgrade the warhead. Mm-hmm. So in a real world, you send a military drone with photo camera. Oh, you find something. And you want to fight. You have to send your drone back to the base to replace the camera with a missile and send it back. In cyberspace, press the button.
So reality is an ancient version of the cyber. No?
Yes.
No, but there is always
yes. Okay. More fast, more quick. Yes, maybe.
Yes.
Reality 2.0. excuse me. Before modern transportation, the world was huge. Yes? This month, I have a round the world trip. This month is Washington, Moscow, Washington, D.C., London, Munich, Tel Aviv, Jerusalem, Barcelona, Yakutsk. It's in the middle of Siberia. Bali. Barcelona, Yakutsk, Bali. San Francisco, back home. The world is small because of the transportation. Transportation changed that. Cyber changed the world as well. So, yeah. Excuse me.
Yes.
150 years ago, no power, no electricity. Do you remember?
No.
Do you remember? No. By the way, our kids, they will not remember the world without internet, without cyber. I still remember. Yeah, they still remember. Yes, yes. The handwritten, handwritten emails, paper mails, snail mails.
They are saying we are primitive. We are using emails. Emails is for the old guys. So.
Yes, I agree.
Yeah. Facebook emails.
Yeah.
Just
but the kids, they will not accept this. What's. By the way, when I'm talking about the digital, I'm sorry. That's it. When I'm talking about digital IDs, many people say that I'm promoting Big Brother. Listen, digital IDs, it's the only way to save democracy. Simply because young generation will never go physically to the election offices. Why? Press the button. To have a promo for every president, every candidate, to check the Facebook of each of them, and then press the button. But if election is not secure, this is a way for falsifications. So the bad guy will watching the election. He'll, okay, I don't this guy and I don't this guy and slide. The result. Yes. So the only way how to make election 100% safe, secure, and falsification free, digital IDs, biometrical digital IDs. And I don't want to say that everyone must have it. No, if you don't want to have the biometrical digital ID, don't use it. But in this case, you have physically go to the election office. You have option. If you don't want to have a digital ID, well, you have physically go to the bank with another ID, with your with your driving license, with your passport, or whatever, with different ID. If you don't want to use it, don't do that. There still are people which don't use credit cards. Yes?
There.
Wise,
but weird.
Yes.
Wise. Wise people don't Wise. Use credit cards. Okay, okay. Yeah, yesterday I tried to use credit card in Tel Aviv.
Okay.
Four times failed.
My name is Dr. Rachel Suisa, and I come from the Technion. My interest is completely about strategic thinking, or maybe better to say it is rethinking strategy with cyber. So what I should say is, first of all, if I may, it would be an optic misperception to consider these great differences between cyber and the physical. In what sense? In terms of strategy. For instance, as you put it in intelligence, when you take the cyber intelligence, no one bases his evaluation or his what to do only on cyber. It is integration of the human and the SIGINT, etc. It is much more. One question about NATO. You mentioned NATO. Mm-hmm. We know that there are many tensions within the different organizations giving out the outputs in intelligence. It was a traditional situation in which Britain belonged, is Britain in national terms, Britain belongs to the EU, and Britain belongs to NATO, all right? So what does she give as output? How cyber will exacerbate these structural tensions in intelligence? This mm-hmm. is one question.
Mm-hmm.
And the other question is, you sort of made a difference between sabotage and the crimes, right? And I think it is, in strategic terms, once again, it's some kind of an artificial difference. Because, for instance, NATO or other, even Israel now started what we call civil-military jointness, right? Because there is a shift or a change in threat perceptions,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
right? So how do you see this also, this problem also? Just a few questions.
Cyber is cyber. Cyber is developed with the speed of cyber. Governments, they still behave with the speed of governments. Government agencies which use cyber, they behave in a cyberspace with the speed of cyber. But outside of cyber, we behave with the speed of governments. In some cases, they cooperate and they know each other. In some cases, there's some, I believe, there's integrated actions. But in some cases, as I know, they're really disconnected even within NATO. So the cyber security agencies, I don't want to mention countries. I don't want to mention the names of these organizations. But this year, we had a very strange request from one NATO country called us to connect them to another cyber organization in a different NATO country. I said, it's the most easy way. I said, yes. They said, yes, you're a private company. You don't need to follow bureaucratic procedures. Go. Next day we did it. So unfortunately, that was the first half of your question. That's still they don't well. I think when our kids replace us, they will behave with the speed of cyber. And a very good explanation is that there are two different nations in the cyber: digital natives and digital immigrants. We are immigrants, ladies and gentlemen. I can recognize, I don't need to check your IDs. We're not in the United States, but I see you are digital immigrants. Our kids, most of them, they're digital natives. And they will behave in absolutely, they do behave in a different way. And I'm pretty sure that in 20, 40 years, 50 years from now, when our kids will replace us, or even earlier, 10, 15, 20 years, they will discuss similar issues in a very different way. So governments will be different.
Actually, you gave me an answer, because this is a problem. We always spoke about revolution.
It's not a problem of human nature. It's a problem of our generation.
Yes, in concrete terms,
because we are living on the border. Yeah. We still don't understand what's that.
Yes. In strategic terms, this is the point. We always spoke about revolution in military affairs. Cyber is a unique revolution.
It's a very unique revolution, like machine guns, like aircrafts, jets, like submarines were developed many years.
But it changes. It changes between the military and the civil ranks.
If you check the history, if you check the Second War, First and Second World War, and after the later conflicts, they did a lot.
So what can do an organization like ISO, non-profit organization, to meeting the cyber threats for the public interest? We want to establish information security data. What else can we do to do it?
Well, I think that's the right strategy of cyber resilience, of making the critical and non-critical systems more immune. It's a cooperation of private sector and government and non-profit organization. Private sector, it's technologies, services, products. Government, regulation, education, and the rest for their non-profit organization to meet private sector and government and to share, to promote these ideas. Promote the ideas of, first of all, government regulation, and I think it's a bad idea if every nation designs their own IT security regulation. Computer systems are the same. In the past, Japan had their own systems in NEC, NEC. There was a little bit different. There were little bit different computers. Do you remember? Mm-hmm. Now it's the same. Your best friends in the Middle East also use Microsoft Windows and Linux, the same systems. So that for government, I think it's a very good idea if it's like an international coordinated project. Or let's wait when United States does that and just copy-paste. I don't know. Well, I don't know. But I think there have to be some kind of regulation introduced by governments. That could be international project or wait for United States to make a example for the rest of nations.
Some kind of integration between all the organization.
Exactly. It's for government. For private sector, it's about to make some physical stuff, to make the bars on the Windows. And other organization to make the part in that, in promoting the ideas, in education, making the connection from private sector to government.
So you find the non-profit organization very important to the public.
Yes, of course. Yes.
An integrator or a cooperation between.
There is no difference. Well, there is a very little difference between traditional world and the cyberspace.
Awareness.
Agree?
Awareness.
Agree.
Yes.
My name is Shuki Ferg, Head of Information Security for a banking group. You're talking a lot about regulation and standards, and I fully agree with you, but if we look at the IT product software, which is developed almost anywhere in the world, it's different components. We have a supply chain, not one person is building a product, it depends on different places. If you look at the physical world, if a building code is not done, the building collapses in the first earthquake. How are we going to change this? Do we make the shift from the way software is developed right now, or IT systems are developed right now, to the next phase? What is going to be, in your opinion, the the paradigm shift is going to enforce that, and what are we going to do in the meantime?
Yes, very good. Actually, when I'm talking about the quality of the software and the procedures of the software development, I use exactly the same analogy. Buildings. When the first two-level building was built by humans, do you remember?
A long time ago.
Well, in Santorini, it's a Greek island. There are three-level buildings found in a volcanic age, which were built 1,500 years before BC. So they are, yes, okay, but pyramids is not like a building, so it's like it's this. So that building in Santorini, they had water pipes and canalization. So it's more than 3,000 years of history of making buildings. So humans learned a lot from the mistakes. Software, less than 100. Please wait for 3,000 years and the problem will be fixed. the new technologies are, there is an option. You make it more safe and more secure, or you lose competition. We don't have time to make it more safe. I'm talking about the standards of software engineering, standards of the quality of the software. I think it's a global problem, and it's a problem of the nature. It's not possible to fix that because it's so rapidly being developed. So we don't have time to stop and to make it more safe by design. If they do it, we will lose competition. Others, which, and this is exactly the same to the critical infrastructure. In the past, there were no issues with security. They could think about security, but if they were more investing more into the critical infrastructure security, losing competition because others will do exactly the same service for cheaper, less price. You are losing competition. You invest more into security, you are losing competition, but you are better protected. But it's like a casino. You don't know when, you don't know how. Unfortunately. But well, I'm sure that in some years, I don't think within our lifetime, maybe after us, this golden age of cyber innovation will be over. So everything will be invented, and we will need no more innovations. So there will be time for safety and security, like airplanes. There were age of innovation, better, faster transatlantic flights, trans-Pacific flights, more and more. Now, okay, let's make it double disc, okay. Let's make it from the new materials and make to consume less petrol, less gas, okay. But there is no real innovation. It's all technologies which are working better, or all ideas done in a little bit different way. So these industries, they have more time to make these technologies more safe and more secure. Yes, so I'm thinking about other analogies. You can find many other analogies. Innovation, then technologies, benefits, security issues. Okay, security technologies to make this, more secure, more safe, more secure. Agree? Good example there, Israel. Innovation, technologies, benefits, security issues. Agree? So it's not about cyber, it's not about planes, it's all on a state level as well.
It's all about being here for more 3,000 years.
You moderate, okay.
My name is Tapavla, I'm a researcher of the internet in Southern the Middle East, and I wonder if you can share with us some information and insights regarding the cyber activities and capabilities in the Middle East and Iran and so on, as far as you know from
about cyber activities from Iran?
The Islamic world, the Middle East, as far as you know, from your daily activities?
Almost not visible behind Chinese speaking attacks, Spanish and Russian speaking attacks. And we don't do detailed research on every attack. I don't know how many files we collect every day, but it's about 200,000 malicious files every day. It's not possible to make a deep research on every attack. We process this automatically. We have a systems for the face recognition, smell recognition, behavior recognition, family recognition, so we make the automatic analysis and detection for most of them. So we don't. It's like a malicious noise in the internet, and we are like a noise canceling system, and we don't recognize which language is spoken in this noise. But we can, in some cases, we can recognize the language. So mostly that's Chinese. Mostly that's Chinese. Second, Spanish, Portuguese, because it's very so close languages that we can't recognize. English, Russian, Arabic, from time to time. Persian, I don't know. But it's very difficult to attribute. If I were working for this kind of organizations, I would develop the malware which speaks Hebrew and run it from a territory of Tel Aviv University, for example. Attribution is very tricky, is extremely tricky. So the very good example of the attribution is attack on Saudi Aramco. Saudi Arabia, very good friend of Europe. In this attack, there was a text string. Arab Gulf. And I said, that's definitely made by Arabs because Persians will never call Persian Gulf Arab Gulf. And my experts, they argued me and said, Eugene, listen, they did it for purpose. And I said, okay, 50-50. We don't know.
In terms of combinatorial and accumulation, you can't start referring. That means don't lose all the information, even if you think it is not worth it at the tactical moment. But can you sort of accumulate it for combinatorial purposes in order to detect who is it? Is my question?
Yes. We announced a new attack Net Traveler. This attack has a lot of Chinese simplified text in the body. The command center, we managed to find the software which managed that. It speaks Chinese simplified as well. The files, they were compiled. So there's a compilation time in the files. From 9 o'clock in the morning to 6 o'clock in the evening, Beijing time. The common centers, they were managing the malware from Chinese provinces. 1, 2, 3. But we don't say China. That technically it's possible to run this attack from any other nation,
exactly.
Pretending to be.
By proxy.
And having the people who speak Chinese, who can design that, but it's more expensive. So maybe that's China. Most probably that's China. But again, I can't point a finger. Well, the only way how to point a finger to attribution is to locate the people who are behind this attack, to surround them and to collect the proofs. It's exactly the same as a computer police departments they are operating. So they are tracing the source of the attacks. Then for some period of time they are watching, they are collecting the links to others because they don't want to arrest just one person, they want more people in the prisons. So they surround them, they collect the data, so this is an attribution. Then they arrest them and they make an investigation. So in most of cases, cyber criminals, when they see the police officer, next second they cooperate. When they see police, they say yes immediately in most of cases. So this is the way of attribution. In case of espionage,
espionage is different.
So I deal with big data analytics, and you know, in big data, 68% of the data is generated by the users, unlike it was 20 years ago, and a similar amount is consumed by the single users. And my question now, today I assume that most of your customers are big companies and government agencies. Do you have any thought of going to produce products that single users will need for their own security?
It's about our products. Very, very simple answer. We have products for consumers, for Windows consumers, Mac, and mobile phones and tablets. In the future, for TV sets as well, because TV also will use smart TVs. So same. One of my employees, he bought the, what's the name of that? The running in a gym, you jogging on this machine, on the running, yeah, Android based, connected to the internet. Simply because they want to, it's an option. If you want to collect your data, you run in different places, but it's connected to the same service, yeah. And you just accumulate your results. That's it. So we have the products for this. We have products for enterprises to protect the endpoint in enterprise environment. Desktops, servers, file servers, mail servers, gateways, we have it in place. Next for us is the protection of critical infrastructure, secure operating system and default deny mode, which was just explained. And our business is split in consumer and enterprise. In some countries, we just dominate the market and we have a very big market share in consumer space. In some countries, we have a big market share in enterprise. We were most successful in the consumer segment. About 60% of our business is consumer based. Simply because when we came to the developed markets, we were a little bit late. There was Symantec, McAfee, Trend Micro, Dr. Solomon, Sophos, and many, 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 many others. What was okay?
So we
came later, so we are still catching up.
But we have protecting them, or maybe you know all these agencies that collect information about the users. When you go to a credit card, what about protecting their identity? Not protecting from attack on their own infrastructure, but
protecting
their
identity.
The identity or knowledge about them.
Actually, there's almost no difference in who is watching, criminals or governments, because it's the very same technologies.
Yeah.
They're just watching the data which is used in your computer, which is your messages, your, transactions, what else, what you're typing on the keyboard. So it's no difference. So if you protect from criminals, we are better protecting from the any other attacks as well.
I have standardized development models and also
standard way is to interconnect to other software. Then we can already trade, but software, and this, I think this is not being emphasized enough in the software development world. I see that with software that we buy.
Yeah, I got it. Unfortunately, the difference between cyber and the traditional world is that the cyberspace is not the same as being developed year by year. When we're talking about the buildings, 3,000 years ago, it was the same gravitation, the same wood, same stones, same water, as far as I remember. Cyber is not the same. 5 years ago, there were no smartphones. Oh, well, there were smartphones, but they were different. They were just like a prototypes of existing technologies. 10 years ago, there were no social networks. 15 years ago, there were no online banking. 20 years ago, there was just a very early age of internet. 25 years ago, no internet, no mobile phones. Come on, it's still a very, very new era. And unfortunately, it's a good thing that it's still being developed. So there is no time and there are no reason actually to make it more secure by design. Because if you do it more secure, we will stop innovations. It's about software and technology for general purpose. When we're talking about critical infrastructure, yes. This is the place to introduce much more strict regulation, security, standards, penalties, what else? And other computer systems somewhere in between. So I'm afraid it's not possible to develop truly secure software and systems for consumer market, because companies, vendors which develop more flexible, more innovative and insecure systems, they will win the market. But for critical infrastructure, that's different.
What do you think about the Apple walled garden approach with iOS? My name is Guy Guzner. I'm from Checkpoint Software, so we're actually good partners.
Yes, I know. Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool.
So what do you think about Apple walled garden approach as a model to achieve the security? Don't you think it achieved more secure than Windows? For comparison?
It's not about security. It's about controlling their whole line, hardware, software, and user, to make it under the control. It's not about security. Security is a side effect of that. iOS is much more secure than other operating systems, but it's less flexible to develop software for this system. And I am absolutely sure that systems which are more friendly, more open, and systems where it's more easy to develop software application services for this particular system, they will win the market. 3 years ago, I had a bet with a friend of mine. I said 3 years ago that in 5 years, Android will have 80% of market share. Apple will have 10%. iOS will have 10% of market share. And other operating systems will split the rest of 10%. Recently, we got a report that Android on the new devices has a 70-something percent on the new devices. Because it's more flexible, it's more easy to implement. It's exactly the same story. Do you remember fight between Apple Macintosh and IBM PC computers? Who was the winner? Why? Because they let others do that.
He's spreading up now. He's getting back up now. In the US, it's the most popular.
Simply because Microsoft made many mistakes, unfortunately. But now with Windows 8, they're catching up with it because it's more fast, more quick, more stable system. There's a touch screen. When I see Mac users, old school. I have a touch screen on my PC, on my computer. So I'm not going to promote Windows. I'm not going to fight with Mac, but I think that reality is that more open systems, they have more chances to win. And about security in these machines, yes, it's more secure, but it's less flexible. And unfortunately, there are some worst case scenarios for iOS systems because it's still vulnerable. It's possible to infect it. It's possible to own it. It's possible to unlock it, jailbreak. And it's possible actually to do it without user notification. So the worst case scenario is if some very bad guy develops malware which infects iOS machines, mobile phones, tablets, security companies, IT security companies, not able to fix the problem because we're not allowed to develop true endpoint security. So we're giving up. It's not my company, it's for the industry. Apple as a company, it's not able to fix the problem because they're not prepared for that. It's not Microsoft. Microsoft, they had a very bad time in early 2000. So Microsoft has all the security procedures in place. So patches, upgrades, etc., etc. So it's automatic. Apple is not as well as Microsoft in this area. So if there is an epidemic of the iOS malware, it will be the best day for Samsung.
Why there is if?
Pardon?
Why there is if?
If there will be
epidemic.
When?
I don't know. I don't manage the bad guys.
Yeah. It's already there.
Yeah. But you can predict it.
Well, actually, there were proof of concepts for iOS malware, and there was a story that one of the Apple employees published some data about zero-day attacks on the, do you remember this story? And he was fired after that. So it's possible that why cyber criminals, why bad guys, they don't pay attention to these machines. Maybe they are simply happy with Microsoft Windows and Android. It's more easy to develop malware for these systems. Why there are not so many attacks on Mac? Mac is more vulnerable than Microsoft Windows. I think that there are still attacks. We collect some dozens of the attacks every year. I think it's simply because there are not so many Mac engineers. Well, it's I have about 1,000 people in R&D. So we have about 1,000 technical guys. Unfortunately, not in Israel, but we're opening the office here. So maybe, I promise that I said we have plans to open office in Israel last year. After 1 year, I'm sorry for being so slow, but we did it. So maybe, not maybe, we have a plan to find the engineers, so security experts in Israel to watch the situation here and to assist the rest of the team with their brains. So it's easy to find, not easy, but it's possible to find these guys. It's very difficult to find Mac engineers. Very difficult to find Mac engineers. We have thousands of people, and I know how easy. Windows, easy. Android, easy. Mac. So I'm pretty sure cyber criminals, they're facing exactly the same problem. So most of their Mac attacks, they're very direct, they're targeted. So it's not criminal attacks, we're just looking for the random victims. They know who is using, and they know that they are using Mac.
I just wanted to say, Sergio Novikov was here last month at your company, and he gave a presentation which he showed a slide that said that there was more malware out there for Mac than for any other system. So for whatever reason, it doesn't get the computers, but it's cheaper. He had a whole list of prices that that Black Hat hackers charge for developing malware, and Mac was the cheapest because it's easiest to do or there's a lot of possibilities.
Well, sure, I don't know exactly what kind of presentation you're talking about because
it was
I don't.
Opening the office here, I was like about a month ago.
But reality is that it's possible to develop. There are many vulnerabilities, and the Mac system, the operating system itself, is more vulnerable than Microsoft Windows. there are some engineers doing the stuff, the malware for Mac, but they're not many. There are much more Windows engineers. And now there are more and more Android engineers.
If I want to take three things that we can do tomorrow morning in the ISOC, so I can say that you said about the increasing of the awareness. That's something that we can do, can take on ourselves to increase the awareness for cyber attacks and cyber vulnerability.
Yeah, three things. I have the list.
Okay, you can say it for me.
Yeah, sure.
So
you wanted to make it easy for you.
Yeah. I want to make it easy for you.
Yeah.
But if you want.
No. Okay. First of all, IT security education in universities. Because we need every nation, Israel as well, we need more IT security engineers, and it's not enough of people to make the system more safe and more secure. Recently, United States, they are discussing new immigration regulations, so they attract more engineers. I said, okay, guys, are you sure that it will help you? IT security in the critical infrastructure? No, because for sure you will not give access to the critical infrastructure
to immigrants.
So you must have your natives. So that's why education. Second, training for employees in every organization which has access to the critical data. It's easy, 45 minutes presentation. Talk to Noam. This is a man to contact. To get this data from. And third, I think it's to help us to build the IT security community here in Israel, and not just ours, maybe with other security companies as well, with our competitors as well, just to have this community of people to have their meetings, to share their ideas, and to promote these ideas to the rest of the nation.
This is very important.
1, 2, 3, that's it. No money,
you've done it better.
No profit, lot of publicity.
In ISOC, I want to say to everybody that in ISOC we establish an academy for just those things of IT, etc. We want to establish an open channel with you all professional in this area and others. Integrated by ISOC, IL, us. This was an important issues that we can take.
Yeah. And please help me to find the reverse engineers, the security experts.
It will cost you 20%.
Please. It's very funny. We have a very international team. So there's people from Latin America, a little bit, from United States, from Europe, from Western and Central Europe. From Russia, a couple of guys in Japan. It's very funny when we see that this is maybe this state-sponsored attack from NATO countries, from United States. So the guys from NATO, from United States and Europe, they are not so happy with that. They're like not so motivated. The Russians say, okay, hey. There was a Red October. There's a little, looks like Russian attack, guys from United States and Europe, come here. And then there was a net traveler, there was Chinese attack altogether. So I want to have the guys from Israel to be in this team because it's from the, well, will be more interesting to fight. I know.
Actually, we have
all. I know.
Actually, we have in Israel. All. We have Latin American, Russian, American, everything.
I know Russian. One quarter of the country is Russian speaking.
They're all natives.
My mom came here to Israel in 5 years ago, maybe. So, I love the country because everyone speaks Russian.
Okay. Another one.
More questions, please, because I don't promise that I come to your country back soon, maybe next year only, because there's so many countries around the globe. So,
Eugene, somewhat to conclude the meeting, it's yours.
To conclude the meeting, the reality is The reality is that we depend on IT systems. That's everywhere, and so they are, unfortunately, they're vulnerable. So these are their Hollywood movies. They explain a lot. So I'm working with IT security for 20 years and having this data. I'm paranoid. It's a professional disease. Because I see all that. Well, and I don't share all data. There are much worse stories, which are reality. Well, attacks which happened, so if it gets to the news, yes, we comment it. But there are some data which we don't share to everyone. I'm sorry for that. So I'm paranoid because I see what's going on in the cyberspace. But at the same time, I'm optimistic. We will survive. So in short, it's very bad. But we will survive.
It will be war. Okay. I want to thank Mr. Kaspersky for his wisdom that shared with us. I want to thank you all.
My paranoia. sharing my paranoia.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you.
Internet magia lechulanu.